Pleasure that we welcome John Carmody to the CFA. John received his bachelor's degree at the University of Toronto and his PhD at Caltech. He did his thesis with Walt Sargeant. And in 1990, he was appointed professor at the Institute for Astronomy at the University of Hawaii. And then in 2000, he was given the Curtis T. Vaughan Jr. Centennial Chair in Astronomy at the University of Texas in Austin. John has received many awards, but two of the better one known are he received the Royal Astronomical Society Gold Medal, and he also received the Astronomical Society of the Pacific Mulman Prize. He's known for his work in the search for black holes and galaxy nuclei, for elliptical galaxies, and the bulge of disk galaxies. These two subjects are also the subject of two very highly cited annual reviews articles that John wrote. And he's also involved with dark matter studies and the evolution of galactic structures. One little thing about John is not well known, that he and his wife Mary are very avid bird watchers. And they have on his website is an amazing collection, both in quality and quantity, of birds from all over the world. You should, if you get a chance, go and look at it. It's really quite impressive. So with that, I would like to introduce John, and he's going to speak on the coevolution or not of supermassive black holes and host galaxies. John?
Thank you very much. And thank you for that very warm and welcome. It's a great pleasure to have assorted dynamical processes, much like the ones that I discussed at lunchtime today, finally allowed me to settle into the center of astronomy in the U.S. to be here. I've never been here before, and it's been a great pleasure to come here. I want to give you now today an update on a subject that is enormously popular in our field, which is how supermassive black holes at the centers of galaxies do or do not influence the evolution of their galaxies. This is M87 with its jet as an introduction to the general topic. And this is a subject that we, Lewis Ho and I, worked on for about 4 years, full-time work, to try to bring every aspect of the observations and the interpretations of them in the context of this as up-to-date as we could. That includes reviewing the technology of black hole mass measurements and trying to improve the accuracy with which we know black hole masses. But the low-hanging fruit in this subject actually turned out to be the study of the host galaxies, because people had put enormous effort into the technology of measuring black hole masses, and many host galaxies were virtually completely unstudied. People had measured their velocity dispersions for reasons that you know and I will in a moment remind you of, but the rest of the information about the host galaxies weren't known. And so a good part of the many years of work that went into this review went into measuring the properties of the host galaxies, and I'll try and tell you what we found out. So a very short summary is going to be that black holes correlate in terms of their masses with classical bulges, the ones that are like elliptical galaxies, and with elliptical galaxies in ways that you know and probably love, but not with disks, not with the pseudo-bulges that I talked about at lunch, and I will remind you of what those were, and not with dark matter halos in some way that goes beyond the correlation that's already here. And those correlations will allow us to refine a little bit our picture of coevolution and lead us to propose that there are essentially four, I'm going to call them modes, I don't know what the right word is, four different ways in which you can look at or think of the coevolution or not coevolution of galaxies in their hosts. And that will lead into another subject which is extremely popular. People are extremely interested in understanding in the color magnitude diagram the blue cloud red sequence transition, and that is the transition of the quenching of star formation. What is it that quenches star formation? And I'm going to try to show you why I think we now have quite a robust picture of how that quenching happens in the nearby universe. And it's probably not greatly wrong at redshifts like 2, but it's certainly going to be a little bit wrong in detail. That I have discussed in more detail than in a preprint of a book chapter that's also out. So the short summary of what we're going to talk about There are correlations between black hole mass and bulge luminosity and black hole mass and bulge mass. And then there's a very good correlation between black hole mass and sigma, which Avi Loeb actually suggested we look for, and we found it indeed, and it's become kind of the controlling correlation in most people's minds. And that has led to the conclusion that starts my talk, the conclusion that's out there in the literature that you'll know about, and that's that the formation of bulges and ellipticals and the growth of their black holes, which happens in part as AGNs happen together and influenced each other. But I'm going to introduce the new notion, or the hopefully improved notion, that enthusiasm in the galaxy formation community for the idea that black holes and galaxies regulate each other's growth so much that they grow in lockstep is rather overdone. So let me start with the best version of these correlations before our work, which is a very good paper by McConnell and Ma. And this shows black hole mass against the luminosity in V-band of the host bulge, and black hole mass against the velocity dispersion 1D of the projected 1D of the host bulge. You'll see these correlations over and over in the talk. The different symbols are coded partly according to the technique used to measure mass and partly according to galaxy type. I don't want to focus on that part right now. And what these correlations have said for years and years and more points is that higher mass and luminosity bulges have bigger black holes, higher velocity dispersions at radii where the stars don't dynamically know about the black hole correlate with black hole mass. But what you can see here is that in both correlations, the total scatter goes over about 1.5 or 2 orders of magnitude. Here it's 2 orders of magnitude. And here it's 1.5 or so, and then there's this guy. And what's missing from here, it's as I said, it's a very good paper, but it's honorably missing a few things that you find if you look at this subject in great detail, are the following things. First of all, some of the black hole masses, especially up here, are wrong. And I'll show you why I think so. Secondly, there are no luminosities in this diagram for late-type bulges. You notice there are blue points here. Those are velocity dispersions of late-type galaxies, but there aren't any blue points over here. And that's part of the, what I was trying to tell you at the beginning, that the host galaxies had been studied in great detail, and so the luminosities for the bulges, bulge disk decompositions that give you luminosities for the bulges, had not been done. And that's with a shortfall. There's no differentiation in this diagram between classical and pseudo-bulges. That's going to be very important. There's no differentiation in this diagram between old, finished, relaxed, smooth ellipticals, the kind that you're used to thinking of, and mergers that are in progress now, and that's going to turn out to be important. And the other thing is that it uses largely, but not completely, published black hole masses for giant ellipticals that were determined with technology that included using dark matter in the models. And that's going to turn out to be an important point. So this isn't a big problem because a lot of the points up here do include dark matter, but some don't, and that's a problem. And the consequence of all this is that the scatter is large, as you see, and several new conclusions that involve this stuff and other things are missed. And that's where we're going to go in this talk. So the theme of this talk and of our review is that when you look carefully, black hole masses turn out to correlate differently with different galaxy components that have different formation histories, and you know what those formation histories are to a fairly large extent. And that's good news because it allows you to refine your picture of how black holes and galaxies do or don't influence each other. That's the good news. And it is really mostly good news. The caveat is only a caveat for the sort of circumstance we've got here today in this room where I have to give you a talk in an hour. I have to introduce a number of details about galaxy structure that are diagnostic of formation physics in ways we understand and that have implications about this subject, but they're complicated details that are hard to squeeze into an hour. So I'm going to try and be efficient and show you those things. And the stuff that I don't get to or that I shortchange by talking about too quickly are in the reviews. We now have detections of black holes using, and I'm only going to talk about detections that are based on kinematics of spatially resolved regions near the center in which the black hole dominates the dynamics. I'm not going to use black hole masses from reverberation mapping, although they're pretty good, and I'm not going to use black hole masses from things like H-beta line widths and AGNs, although they're getting better. So this is only the kind of galaxies where we've done resolved spectroscopy, spatially resolved spectroscopy of the sphere of influence of the black hole. 44 ellipticals, 42 disk galaxies, which happen by accident to be equally divided between classical bulges and pseudobulges, and I will explain that difference as I go along in the talk. And one of the things that has happened is that the state of the art in the stellar dynamic part of this subject, right, you can do dynamics with gas, you can do dynamics with stars, this is with stars, has gotten very high. The bar has been raised very high. And the state of the art now is to use Schwarzschild's orbit superposition method to make dynamical models. And forgive me, I do not have time to go through the details of how that is done. But those models are very powerful in terms of pulling out details from the dynamics. And a recent development that began in around 2009 or 10 is that started to add halo dark matter to the dynamical models. And that has influenced the black hole masses that we deduce in the way that you would guess. If you blame some of the kinematics on dark matter and not on the stars, you conclude that the mass-to-light ratio of the stars is smaller than you used to think. And you don't let the mass-to-light ratio of the stars vary with radius. So if you drop the mass-to-light ratio of the stars, you do it at all radii. And that means to continue to fit the kinematics, you have to up the black hole mass correspondingly. And so the generic result of doing this has been that estimates of black hole masses have grown bigger. And one of the results is that we've been able to do objects that we just couldn't do before. And one of those objects is M87. And the result there is that the stellar dynamical mass with dark matter in the models of the black hole is estimated to be 6 plus or minus not much, 10 to the 9 solar masses. And that no longer agrees with the mass of about 4 plus or minus not much times billion solar masses derived from HST spectroscopy of the ionized gas rotation curve. And that is the beginning of a new result. And that new result is shown here. So from here on, the talk is about new results. So this is now the first version from our data of black hole mass versus K-band now luminosity of the bulge, and black hole mass versus the same sigma that you've been looking at, the same velocity dispersion. At the moment, I'm not differentiating bulges from ellipticals. The points that are in black are the points that we trust. M87 is up here, M32 is down here. And what we now see is that certain points which have been colored purple are systematically low here. And they are the ones that are derived from ionized gas dynamics when the authors realized and said in the paper that the emission line widths were comparable to the rotation velocities that they were using, but they calculated mass as V squared R over G without using the line width. Now, that doesn't have to be wrong if the lines are broad because there's internal turbulence in the clouds, but the actual bulk motions of the clouds are controlled by the gravity of the center plus stars, then this isn't wrong. But if, on the other hand, that isn't the case, and the velocity dispersion in the gas is part of the dynamical support, then you're going to underestimate the black hole mass. In the early days, we didn't know which one was right. But now that those particular points and only those points are low, it begins to be clear that they underestimate the black hole masses. And that's particularly clear because in a couple of cases, here's 3998, they have both a stellar dynamical and a gas dynamical measurement. And the gas dynamical measurement is much smaller than the stellar dynamical one. M87, the same is true. Neither of these purple points deviate from the scatter. But you can tell from the comparison with stellar dynamical ones that the masses are indeed coming out small. And in these cases where you don't have stellar dynamical ones, the fact that the masses look too small compared to the scatter makes us conclude that the masses probably of all the purple points are wrong. And so we're going to omit them from now on. There are also two stellar cases that are almost certainly wrong, but I don't have time to tell you why. Just don't worry about them. They're a problem. So that's the first conclusion and the first pruning. Right? We'll prune out the galaxies whose black hole masses were measured from gas rotation curves when the line widths were very broad and ignored. When the line widths are very broad and are not ignored and put into this analysis, then the points are black with purple centers, and they're okay, and we keep those. But if the line width was ignored, we'll drop the points. Next new conclusion. Now I have added 5 points that weren't there before, and they are 5 galaxies that are mergers in progress right now. And some of them you know well, like NGC 1316, 5128, these are well-known nearby mergers. These are not so well-known, and 2 of them are shown up here. So you can see the loops and shells that are characteristic of mergers in progress, where the disks that got merged are still at large radii, where the dynamical clocks run slowly, remembering the encountered geometry a little bit, and allow you to recognize mergers in progress. And they turn out to be low outside the scatter of the other objects, at least in black hole mass bulge luminosity, and to some extent in black hole mass Cygnus. So the first new science conclusion, not technology conclusion, is that zero redshift mergers in progress are at least frequently low below the scatter of the correlations. And we can understand that at least in part because I will show later in the talk that when you look at pure disks that don't have a bulge component, some of them do have black holes, but they have very much smaller black hole mass fraction compared to the disk than ellipticals have in their black holes compared to the elliptical. So if you now take 2 pure disks with little black holes and merge them, it will turn into 1 elliptical. The stars will get scrambled up. All the stars that used to call disk stars, you're not going to start calling elliptical galaxy stars. But the black hole masses can't grow very much because gas fractions at redshift 0 are tiny, and you can't feed up the black holes much. And you know that anyway, because when you look at zero redshift mergers in progress, they don't have quasars in them at redshift 0. They have quasars in them at redshift 2. So I think we can understand part of this. And there are certain worries that you might have about the technology. Here's one, for instance. Suppose you're using HST to look at a merger in progress, and you've got a long-slit spectrograph, because that's what HST has, and you put the slit across the center of the galaxy, and you fail to find a normal mass big black hole. Could it be that you just missed, right? I mean, where in the universe would you most expect to find black holes that are not in the middle of their galaxies? And the answer is things like this that are still violently relaxing. If the black hole sloshes, maybe it's just not at the center and you didn't put the slit on it. But that worry is not as bad as you might think, because 2 of these masses, in fact, those 2, were determined by Maser people here. And they don't care where the black hole is as long as it's in the single dish field of the telescope. They'll find the black hole anywhere in the galaxy. So, you know, that's it's really nice that 2 of these galaxies, the 2 of the most deviant ones, were found by the Maser people, because that particular technology worry that you might just miss the black holes with a long slit, it doesn't exist. So I think this is a real result. It's a new result in this paper. It's a result that the community hasn't totally absorbed and worked with yet. And I've offered you a bit of an explanation, but probably it's not the whole story. Next new result. The next result is not new in our paper, but it's, of course, something we review. And that is, by the way, I'm not going to plot the mergers from now on so that they don't screw up your mental image of what the correlations look like. They don't fit. Remember, they don't fit. I'm not going to plot them now. What I will plot is these points. There is a small number of galaxies known whose black hole masses are gigantic, 10 or 15% of the stellar mass of the object. And they're way outside the scatter of the other objects. And then there's objects that are sort of near the edge of the scatter where you're not sure whether this is a weak example of this or a slightly divergent version of these guys. There's at least 3, this one, and one that's not plotted here because it's outside the range of the plot. And 4486b is a companion of M87, which we've known about for the black hole for a long time. And this one hit the press a couple of years ago. It was a 2012 Nature paper. This is an S0 in the Perseus cluster. This is one of the compact ellipticals that Igor Chilingarian was talking about. And it's just conceivable that this is a galaxy that was once bigger. He would say that it was a galaxy that was once bigger, and that it's deviant in part because of that. But you'd also say that about M32, and M32 is absolutely normal. So I think M32 is not clearly showing effects of tidal stripping, and whether this is deviant because of tidal stripping, or whether it's the other thing that these things could be, which is relics of a time before these correlations were established, when the black hole mass fraction was typically in most galaxies bigger than it is now. I can pursue this more in the questions if you'd like. We're not totally sure which is right, but for this one, it is more likely to be this, because this is an S0, and its disk hasn't been stripped off. So its bulge certainly hasn't been whacked. And the third one that has been found recently is also in this boat. Then there's an ultra-compact dwarf. Ultra-compact dwarfs might have been stripped. So at least some of this is probably going on. In any case, those galaxies deviate well above the scatter. I'm not going to include them in the derivations of fits. But I am going to leave them in the diagrams colored very lightly so that you can remember them but not overly emphasize them. Okay, having discussed the deviant guys, these are what the correlations now look like. And I'm now differentiating classical bulges from ellipticals, but I haven't plotted pseudo bulges yet. So these are the new version of the correlations with much smaller scatter, having now measured the luminosities of these bulges by doing bulges decomposition carefully. The ellipticals weren't such a problem. There is a very good correlation from the faintest elliptical M32, which looks absolutely completely normal, up to very big ellipticals. No sign of a kink in this correlation. Sigma black hole mass also has a very good correlation. You've known that for a long time. Except up here, there are hints that something is starting to happen. The hints are not statistically terribly robust. One is not completely sure that what I'm going to say next is right. But the hint is that black hole mass is starting to become independent of sigma up here. And that's been noted before. Lauer predicted it, and McConnell et al., who measured some of these points, interpreted their diagram in this light. Why is that happening? Well, we think we understand why it's happening. We think that there is a tendency at these sorts of sigmas for the black hole mass to become independent of sigma, or at least to grow very slowly with sigma, because sigma doesn't grow very much in dry mergers, and that result is what's shown here. So this shows a Faber-Jackson relation. So this is velocity dispersion, the same sigma that you've been looking at. As a function of V-band luminosity for ellipticals, it doesn't much matter whether you use V-band or K-band. The red points are core-less ellipticals. They're the low luminosity ellipticals that the elliptical galaxy folks like the Sauron people would say are the rotators, the disky isophote-shaped ellipticals. I will talk about this distinction of the red points versus the black points more later in the talk, but right now that's enough. And those guys have the steep L is proportional to sigma to the fourth, roughly, Faber-Jackson relation that you've known all your life, basically. But if you go and look at the ellipticals and find the ones that have cores, they are the non-rotating ellipticals, the ellipticals with boxy isophotes, that collection, which overlap with the coreless ellipticals over a significant luminosity range. But you can tell them apart easily. If you color those guys differently, you see they have a much shallower correlation of sigma with absolute magnitude, such that as luminosity increases, sigma doesn't increase so much anymore. Now, if black hole mass correlates with this, but sigma doesn't increase so much anymore, what's going to happen to the black hole mass sigma correlation is that it turns up. And that's what we think we see signs of here. And the galaxies with cores are the ones that have white dots in the middle. They are the ones that are responsible for the effect, except for the monsters. The monsters are another matter. So that's a new result, maybe. I mean, it's a new result that is starting to look interesting, and it's a new result that we have very strong reasons to expect. And this kind of shallow Faber-Jackson relation is predicted for ellipticals that form via purely dry mergers, or black hole binaries scour the cores by flinging stars away from the center. For example, n-body simulations of those get sigma is proportional to m to some tiny power, which is rather similar to the 0.05, 0.09 power that we get here. Whereas, for example, minor mergers imply that sigma actually decreases as the black hole, as the galaxy mass increases, because minor mergers deposit their stuff at large radii. So if you're looking through the galaxy, and my head's the galaxy center, and stars are deposited out here, they tend to be going across the line of sight, and they don't add to the dispersion much. They make dispersion drop if you add lots and lots and lots of them. So we think we understand why this is shallow, and we see an effect from it, maybe. We need more points up here, but the hint is that that effect is there and that we, in fact, understand it. If you now do here the fits, these are the gray shading and lines are symmetric least squares fits where the two variables are treated identically with one sigma error bars. These are the equations for the fits. The point of this slide is not that you read the equations. Black hole mass goes as some power of the bulge mass, which is just a little bit bigger than one, and some power of sigma, which is around 4.5. The important thing I want you to notice is that with the careful look at both host property, host sigma and the host bulge mass, the intrinsic scatter of the black hole sigma relation is exactly the same as the intrinsic scatter of the black hole mass bulge mass correlation. That's a result that the people who work with infrared luminosities have found before, but we've found it here too. The scatter is just marginally less than the infrared luminosity scatter. So it is not true that black hole mass sigma is somehow more magical than black hole mass luminosity. Frankly, I actually like this correlation, trust this correlation a little bit better for messy reasons of technology. When you calculate a black hole mass, you do your best with the Schwarzschild code to fit all the dynamics, including the shapes of the line profiles. There's a lot of information there. But it is nevertheless true that the velocity dispersion over the main part of the galaxy influences the black hole mass that you get. And so at some level, not too strong, but also not unimportant, when you plot black hole mass against sigma, you're plotting a function of sigma against sigma, and the fact that you find a correlation is a little bit built into the technology. At least that's the danger. The good news is that when you look at the black hole masses that come from the Maser people, and again, the Maser people are really important to this story because they don't suffer from any of these technology problems. They have the same scatter as the other points, or even slightly smaller scatter. So I think that although this is a concern that should sort of never completely be forgotten, it isn't seriously screwing up the story. If I now again plot black hole mass against bulge mass, but I've actually plotted the ratio of black hole mass to bulge mass because most people's minds work in terms of what mass fraction is the black hole, and I've expressed it as a percent. These are the data that we've now got, and they imply another new result. The canonical black hole mass fraction that you'll find in the literature in a collection of papers by Merritt and the Nuker team and others from the early 2000s is that the black hole mass is between 0.1% and 0.15% of the bulge mass, and that turns out not to be right. At 10 to the 11th solar masses, the black hole mass fraction is 0.5%. So the canonical black hole mass fraction is about 0.5%, about 4 times bigger than we thought. And this affects arguments like the Sultan argument about whether the energetics of quasars at high redshift do or don't add up to the black hole mass that's left over at redshift zero in actually a rather nice way. It means that you don't need quite such high efficiencies. Anyway, that's a new result. The black hole mass fractions scatter between the old value that you thought was right and about 1% and a bit. And the scatter is what you saw earlier. The intrinsic scatter is about 0.3 of a dex. So that's another new result, the fact that the black hole masses are bigger. And the reason why they got bigger fundamentally is 2.5 things. Big effect came from adding dark matter to the models. That made these black hole mass estimates go up. At low masses, the big effect is to realize that you shouldn't be plotting pseudobulges. I will show you the pseudobulges in a minute, and they're going to be down here. And that made the rest of them, which are the classical bulges, as an ensemble, have bigger masses. And the half effect is the dropping of the wrong masses that were wrong because the emission line widths were ignored. Remember that? That also got rid of some of the low points up here. So we think this is a robust result. Okay, I've now shown you what black hole masses correlate with. Now let's show you what black hole masses don't correlate with. And we'll start by, so this is the start of the discussion of pseudobulges. I'll remind you of the definition of a bulge, that a bulge is sort of conventionally thought to be really nothing different than an elliptical galaxy that happens to live in the middle of a disk. And there's an elliptical, and there's a good example of a bulge which is correctly described by this. And there are plenty that are like that. I should emphasize, it is not a result to be taken for granted, right? Because it could be that there is no bulge that has got the properties of an elliptical that happens to live in the middle of a disk. If you look at the distribution of properties, say the correlations, like fundamental plane correlations of bulges and ellipticals, they're different. So you need to check whether this thing that you thought you believed because of people like Sandage is true or not. And I'll tell you that it's been done, and it is true. In fact, I'll show you one of the bits of evidence in a few minutes. So this is okay. This is a definition that I'm happy with and I trust. And in fact, the mind, of course, takes the necessary next step, which is that they form the same way. And I certainly think I understand that ellipticals form by major mergers. That's a discussion that is currently toastier than it was 10 years ago, but I still think it's right. So a classical bulge is the remnant of a major galaxy merger. And by the way, that includes a new process that you've been hearing about lately, and that is that high redshift, very gas-rich disks tend to be unstable to making clumps, which then sink to the center and dump a lot of gas in the middle and starburst. That's a variant of the merger picture from the point of view of this story. So I'm not arguing against that. When I say the word merger, I include this process. However, there are other ways of making dense galaxy centers. They don't look like this when you look at the galaxy edge on, but when you look at the galaxy face on, you confuse them with bulges. And that was the story of what I talked about at lunch today. So this is the three-slide summary of secular evolution, slow evolution of isolated spiral galaxies, in which non-circular structure, this is an unbarred oval galaxy, rearranged this gas permanently into inner rings, outer rings, that's an outer ring, and stuff that's dumped onto the center, which is here forming a blue starburst ring, and grows a high-density central component, which looks like a bulge to people who do classification, but that wasn't made by events like mergers. It's made slowly in a galaxy that's never far from equilibrium. And here's an example that I did not show at lunchtime, but it's a really nice example from the Sauron team. So this is a nearly edge-on spiral. It's probably barred across here. Infrared view shows the disk, and you see this very high surface brightness thing in the middle. That is what a classical morphologist would have said is the bulge. This is the region that the Sauron folks looked at. And these are the Sauron folks' H-beta line strength, rotation velocity pattern, and velocity dispersion pattern. You notice it's a bit rotated. And this is the brightness profile as a function of linear radius. So let me look at this first. This shows an exponential outer disk. That's this part. And a steep jump in the surface brightness near the middle. That is what any classical morphologist would have said is the bulge. And you'll notice that the radius of this steep surface brightness thing is 10 arc seconds. At about 10 arc seconds, turns over and becomes the disk. Now look at the velocity field. This is a classic recession approach velocity spider diagram, which shows slow rotation in the main part of the galaxy. And then in the middle, there's this thing here, which is rotating very rapidly and is very flat, and which has a radius of just about 10 arc seconds. This is velocity dispersion, small is bluer. A region in the middle whose radius is good part of 10 arc seconds is colder. Colder, more rapidly rotating means more disk-like. That's the sort of observation that I was trying to summarize at lunchtime. This is a pseudo-bulge, not a classical bulge. And I showed this picture at lunchtime. These are 18 by 18 arc second snapshots of the centers of galaxies that have spiral structure at large radii. If you looked at a classic picture in the Carnegie Atlas of these galaxies, this is the part of the picture that would be overexposed. And this is the part of the picture that Sandage or de Vaucouleurs would have called the bulge. And yet, when you look at it with high dynamic range and Hubble Space Telescope spatial resolution, you can tell that it's disky and full of small-scale structure and very cold. You have to be cold to make this kind of stuff. And those, that's how you'd identify pseudobulges. I showed you at lunchtime a list of ways, which I have now shown you three examples of, ways that you can recognize pseudobulges and distinguish them from classical bulges. And we did that. So among the galaxies for which we have stellar dynamical or gas dynamical black hole detections, some are classical bulges and some are pseudobulges. And now I'm adding in blue the pseudobulges to the diagrams you've seen before. And lo and behold, they don't look the same as the red and gray points. So the gray points are ellipticals, the red points are classical bulges, the blue points are pseudobulges. They're not wildly different. The top of the distribution is about the same for all three kinds of points, but systematically the pseudobulges have smaller black holes than the classical bulges with respect to the correlations. And this is not an effect of plotting barred galaxies versus unbarred galaxies, because there are barred galaxies that have classical bulges and their red points, and there are unbarred galaxies that have pseudobulges and their blue points. So this is not an effect that Alistair Graham, for example, has emphasized. Alistair has suggested that barred galaxies have either undermassive black holes, or you get the black hole mass wrong, one or the other. And that isn't this effect, because the galaxies aren't the same. Yes?
John, sorry to interrupt.
It's okay.
Lunchtime also had this doubt.
Yes.
You're talking as if there is a classical bulge and a pseudo bulge.
Yes.
And they never
be. Yes.
And
that's not right.
Going to have a bit of both.
There's going to be galaxies that have a bit of both.
But here you somehow managed
exactly
to separate them out.
Now, what I've done here is I've given it the color of the point of the dominant component. And there are a few, there are some of these blue points that have, roughly speaking, one-fifth of them is classical. And a few of the red points might have a very small pseudo component. In fact, some of them absolutely for sure have very small pseudo components at sort of the 3% level. But it turns out, and there are galaxies where it's very hard to tell which is dominant. But in this diagram, there happen to be only about two of those. And for the rest, it turns out to be quite easy to pick a dominant component and to give it that color. So it's an absolutely correct statement. And when you look at 1,000 galaxies, there must be a significant number there where the pseudo bulge and the classical bulge are about equal. They just don't happen to be in this sample, mostly. Thank you for asking that. When you give a talk on a new subject like secular evolution that you think people haven't heard of, what you always do is you focus on the cleanest cases because you want to make a point. But then somebody will correctly say, as you have, and I appreciate that you have, there are less clean cases, aren't there? And the answer is, of course there are. But these are not a big problem. One or two points are a little bit of an issue. Let me just mention a galaxy that you know well, NGC 1068, one of the original Seyferts, is like 4736. It's a semi-outer ring, whether it's an outer ring or a disk, doesn't matter, with an oval part in here and a very high surface brightness part in the middle that's absolutely a pseudo bulge. That is that point. So the pseudo bulges are really far off. And furthermore, this is another Maser black hole. And so again, we have the benefit of a level of certainty in the black hole mass that you don't usually have when you talk to stellar dynamical people like me. So the result is quite robust. And quite a few of these are Maser points. The Maser people tend to find black holes in pseudo-bulge galaxies because they're using gas. They're using molecular gas, in fact, right? And molecular gas, the star formation, and gas being dumped into the center, that stuff all goes together. So you stack the cards, you roll the dice in your favor to find black holes in pseudo-bulge galaxies by using the Maser technology. And sure enough, it's worked very well, and they found quite a few. A lot of these galaxies, you'd have no hope of finding the black hole from stellar dynamics because they're full of star formation and dust and other stuff that makes the life of an optical observer very hard. So, first of all, I want to just mention that since we're now concluding that black holes correlate only with classical bulges and ellipticals, in other words, only with major merger remnants, it's an important success of this secular evolution picture that I was trying to describe at lunchtime, that morphological differences that you can apply without knowing anything about black holes, or which are or are not at the centers, namely diskiness and rotation over sigma and that kind of feature, divide bulges into two types that afterwards you discover correlate differently with their black holes, implying different growth processes. That's a success of the picture. It's one of the reasons why I like the picture better and better as we learn more and more about galaxies. And it's the reason, it's one of the reasons why I picked this subject, which is otherwise kind of too big for a 15-minute talk, for my lunch talk today. And so to come back to the black hole physics, we conclude that there are two fundamentally different channels of evolution. The biggest black holes grow very rapidly to high mass. I could enlarge on the very rapidly, but you probably know the reasons why I say that already. And they co-evolve with their bulges in the sense that they're the ones that have tight correlations of black hole mass with bulge properties. And they do that via, we think, mergers and quasar AGNs. And those may well affect the growth of the galaxy. In fact, very likely do. But small black holes live in largely bulges, galaxies that have pseudo-bulges, but in a minute I'm going to show you some in galaxies that don't even have pseudo-bulges, live in disks. And they're there because you see the low-level Seyfert activity that's associated with them. They're there because you can measure their masses with reverberation mapping. They're there because sometimes the maser people find them there. But they don't correlate with their host disks in any way at all. And it's no stretch to say that these are very likely the seeds for those, because it's the mergers of galaxies like this that make ellipticals and bulges, we think. So let me enlarge on the lack of correlation with disks. Here's an example. Here's the most extreme known example of a black hole in a late-type galaxy that doesn't even have a pseudo-bulge. This is NGC 4395, a dwarfish S little m spiral, which has at the center, this is not a nuclear star cluster, this thing that I'm drawing a circle around. That is a very mini AGN. And reverberation mapping has been carried out on that, and it gives a quite reliable black hole mass of a few 10 to the 5 solar masses. So the people who have made careers out of working on this kind of object are Jenny Green, Lewis Ho, and their collaborators, and they have correctly concluded from this object, among many others, that a bulge is not necessary equipment for black hole formation. So I've been talking about tight correlations between black holes and their host bulges, but there are galaxies that don't have host bulges. That doesn't mean they don't have black holes. It just means that the black holes don't correlate with their hosts, and that I have to show you, and there it is. So this is black hole mass versus disk luminosity in K-band, and there's no correlation at all. The red points are galaxies with classical bulges, but I've plotted their disks. These are pseudo-bulge galaxies, but I've plotted their disks. These are galaxies that don't have either one, but I've plotted the luminosity of the disk, which they do have. The filled circles are objects where there is a black hole mass measurement, and the open circles are objects in which there's only an upper limit. And the most extreme upper limit is M33, where the upper limit is 1,500 solar masses. So M33 has a moderately bright disk, but really no black hole, whereas the most luminous galaxy of its sort has a disk which has a black hole which is 10 to the 9-ish solar masses, and a disk that's more or less the same luminosity. Black holes absolutely don't correlate with disks. This result, let me just remind you of, there's M33. So this is a galaxy with neither a pseudo-bulge nor a classical bulge. What it has in the middle is this. This is a CFHT image that we took in 1993. And this is an overexposed picture of a nuclear star cluster, an object which is like M22, a big globular cluster. And it's made out of intermediate mass and youngish stars as well as old stars. And we have measured the velocity dispersion of this with the kind of resolution that Couday stellar spectroscopists use. And the velocity dispersion is 20 plus or minus 1 kilometers per second. So it's incredibly tiny velocity dispersion. It's a velocity dispersion that's characteristic of a globular cluster. And from that and dynamical models of the nuclear star cluster, you conclude that you can't hide dark mass hardly at all. The limit on a black hole mass is about 1,500 solar masses. And that was done independently by Merritt and our group, and we essentially agree. So this is not a galaxy in which we look for a black hole and fail. This is a galaxy where we look for a black hole and succeed in showing that there isn't one present, which is a much stronger statement, at least not one that's bigger than sort of roughly that mass. And the result of that is that this correlation here has not just points up here where there's gigantic black holes associated with moderate disks, but the bulge is very big. There's also a point way down here, and it's a very robust point. So the conclusion that black holes don't correlate with disks is quite robust. The conclusion that I need to discuss next is this one. Do black holes correlate with their dark matter halos, the dark matter halo of the galaxy that they live in some way that is more fundamental than the correlation that already you saw with the host bulge? And this is a very important question because the galaxy formation theory and simulation community love the suggestion that was made by a number of people in the early 2000s that the most fundamental correlation may be the correlation with halo mass. And the reason they love it is because they absolutely know how to calculate what the dark matter halo fluctuations will do in terms of evolving. They've got halo finders that tell them the halo mass, and it's really delightful if that tells you everything else that you want to know, like, say, for example, the black hole mass. The fact that it's delightful doesn't necessarily mean that it's right. And I'm sorry, but it isn't. And I need to show you why, because it's such an important result that so many people would like it to be right. So the result was originally based on this correlation, which is the correlation between the circular rotation velocity observed in disks at large radii with, say, H1 rotation measurements against the velocity dispersion at the center, which was assumed to be a surrogate for the black hole mass for the reasons that you know very well and saw earlier. And this is a diagram, doctored version of Ferraresi's diagram. And the black points up here are part of her argument, and they show a very good correlation, very tight correlation, suggesting that this surrogate for halo properties and this surrogate for black hole properties are extremely tightly correlated, and that led to this conclusion. Here are three problems with that. The first one is that only the four objects that are circled are classical bulges. The others are pseudo-bulges, these guys. And I already showed you that sigma is not a surrogate for black hole mass for pseudo-bulges. Sigma doesn't correlate with black hole mass for pseudo-bulges. So if these points and these points correlate equally well with that, it isn't because of something that involves the black hole. What it's in fact doing is it's an outgrowth of another effect that you have known for your whole careers, essentially, and that is the conspiracy, which has a lot of physics behind it, between visible and dark matter to make nearly flat featureless rotation curves. And that whole collection of physics that results in that is what's producing this, not they both know about black holes. Argument one. Argument two is, if the black hole mass dark matter correlation is more fundamental than the bulge correlation, then a test ought to be, does black hole mass correlate with this measurement of the halo in the absence of a bulge? Because the bulge isn't what's fundamental, it's the halo that's fundamental. And the answer is no. Those points are the red points, are the colored points. So this shows VSERC and sigma for a collection of galaxies which have neither a pseudo-bulge nor a classical bulge. And this is M101, the most deviant object. And let me just show you quickly what's going on with M101. So there's a picture of M101. You can see a little bit of brightening toward the middle. We have studied this galaxy in this paper in 2010 in huge detail. It has a tiny pseudo-bulge, which is 2.7% of the galaxy. It's really tiny. It also has a nuclear star cluster, which is even tinier. And it has zero classical bulge And you cannot hide a classical bulge in this object. I mean, look, we can detect a nuclear star cluster that's this small. There's no way you can hide a classical bulge, so there's no classical bulge. What's VCIRC? Well, the H1 people tell us that VCIRC is 202 kilometers per second. By the way, the nucleus has a velocity dispersion of 24 kilometers per second, just like the one in M33, just like a globular cluster. So as soon as you get rid of the bulge, you get a very large amount of scatter in a correlation that's not quite absent. I mean, it remains true that you can feed up bigger black holes in galaxies that have more fuel. So there isn't absolutely no correlation, but there isn't the kind of tight correlation, say like that one, or like black hole sigma, that makes you think coevolution. It's just not there. So that's argument two. And this point is important enough that I'll give you an argument three, which is based on this well-known diagram that shows the ratio of stellar mass to dark matter mass as a function of dark matter mass, as determined from a huge number of techniques. This particular figure comes from Behrouzi. And it shows a very well-known result, which is that there is a sweet spot halo mass of 10 to the 12 solar masses, where the mass in baryons, or the mass in stars, is the biggest fraction you ever see of the dark matter mass. And in smaller galaxies, the ratio goes down, and in bigger galaxies, the ratio goes down too. Here, the ratio goes down not because the baryons are missing, but because they're in X-ray gas. And here, the ratio probably goes down because the baryons have left. But those details are not what I want to focus on. So what I've shown you is that here is that black hole mass correlates with bulge mass, that's M star, very well with no kink at any mass from 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 12 and a bit. And that, this is dark matter mass, that stellar mass is almost in the middle of this. So black hole mass goes as 1 power linearly with no kink of bulge mass over the whole range. But if you use this to calculate from that how it goes with dark matter, then black hole mass goes very steeply with dark matter mass down here and very shallow way with dark matter mass up here. And that's not a simple correlation at all. And it's driven by the physics that makes this kink happen. And we understand what that physics is, and it hasn't much to do with black holes. So these are three among 7 or 8 arguments that we have in the review why we think that black holes don't correlate with dark matter halos, except in the sense that they correlate with bulges in ellipticals. And in a bulge in elliptical, the bulge probably correlates with its halo the way you expect it would. So the summary of where we've arrived at is black holes correlate only with merger remnants, not with disks, not with pseudobulges, and not with dark matter halos in a way that goes beyond that. And I want to just quickly give you a slide that has some perspective implications, and that also addresses a little bit the question of what compact ellipticals are. So this is a version of a diagram that Igor showed too. This is effective surface brightness versus effective radius, both logs. And the pink and orange points, you should ignore the blue points, are the sequence of ellipticals. This is the correlation that I found in my thesis. M87 is here, and that point that looks sort of, is this a circle with a cross through it, is M32. M32 is, according to this, an entirely normal little elliptical. These, the pink guys, are M32 analogs in the Virgo cluster that were in the Atlas of Virgo Galaxies published by Standage, Bingley, Taman, those people. And there's a continuous correlation up to the giant ellipticals. And part of why that's compelling is that the brown points, which are classical bulges, have the same correlation as the ellipticals. And they are for sure not tidally stripped, because the disks are around them. So we think that there is a nice, clean correlation down here. That doesn't mean that there aren't some 4486Bs. It certainly doesn't say anything about ultra-compact dwarfs, which could be tidally stripped. But I don't think M32 looks at all weird. Or it could be that tidal stripping happens, but it moves you along the correlation, but not for the brown points. In any case, why did I show you this diagram? Because that correlation is noticeably different than the correlation of blue and green points. The blue points are the disks of spirals, and down here, the hole of a Magellanic irregular. And the green points are the disks of S0s, and down here are the dwarf spheroidals, or the spheroidals, the things that Igor called dwarf ellipticals. And the conclusion is that there is a continuous correlation with the kink in it, exactly where bulges disappear, between effective brightness and radius, and the galaxies with gas and the galaxies without gas that are disky have the same correlations, and one are probably the defunct versions of the other. Why am I showing you this in a black hole talk? The reason is that black holes correlate in the way that you have seen tightly only with the sequence. And that means that in that sequence, if you were to draw the number of black the number of black holes as a function of mass, mass is going down this way. These would be rare, then there would be a maximum at roughly the middle. So the black holes of that mass living in hosts of that mass would be the most common ones. And then the small black holes in the smallest things that they correlate with would be, again, somewhat rare. So black holes co-evolve only with this sequence, and that means that their mass functions are bounded. There are black holes in some of these objects, but not all of them, and they don't correlate with these things. And so there's probably a correlation here where the black holes, if they ever exist, get more massive as you go along this sequence. But there are many galaxies along that sequence that don't have black holes. And even when they do, the black holes don't correlate with their hosts. And so this two different collections of black holes is worth knowing about. And the black holes in that co-evolve with their bulges are surely the most massive ones in the universe and dominate the mass budget of black holes. But the black holes in disks are probably the most numerous ones in the universe and don't dominate the mass budget of black holes. So this brings me now to my final subject, which is how this talks to the story about AGN feedback. There are many reasons why AGN feedback is popular. You know what's in this slide, so let me not emphasize this slide too much. You know that it is a very popular idea that AGN feedback controls galaxy formation in a way that makes the correlations happen. And here is my problem with that idea. AGN feedback essentially depends on the depth of the potential well. And it's roughly independent of how you arrange the mass in the potential well, whether it's a disk or a bulge. It doesn't matter a lot. What matters is the escape velocity. But black holes are observed to correlate only with bulges and ellipticals, not with these things. And the result of that observation is that you realize that small ellipticals like M32 participate in this coevolution story, whatever it is. But giant pure disks like M101, which is way more massive than M32 in terms of baryons, don't participate. So it would appear that whatever coevolution is about, it's not about mainly mass. It's about whether the mergers have occurred or not. And some more evidence that leads you to think along those lines is shown in the next couple of slides. This is showing the correlations that you saw earlier again for, so this is luminosity and this is sigma, for ellipticals, classical bulges, and pseudo bulges. And at the moment, I want you to actually not even pay attention to the color of the points. And at the lowest level, the conclusion that you get from looking at this is that the scatter gets big down at the bottom, if you don't even want to notice the points. And that reminds you, perhaps, of a result that is shown here. If you don't do any astrophysical, gastrophysical magic, but just do a lot of merging, and you take your black holes from this square, where there's no correlation between black hole mass and the mass of the host, and just take two things and merge them, add the black holes and add the hosts, dry mergers, and keep doing that over and over again, you reproduce a correlation with roughly the right scatter, a decreasing scatter as you go up, and roughly the right slope. And this has been shown independently by Peng. Gaskell got the same idea. Hirschman got the same idea. This comes from Gianca and Macchio. It's the best, cleanest paper on the subject. And so they suggested the dark horse idea that the central limit theorem, which is controlling this result, is a significant part of why we find the correlations, because we find the correlations for things that have undergone mergers. And trust me, most of those, the arguments are very good, have undergone more than one merger. And we don't find them when they haven't undergone mergers. And by the way, that's why it's no surprise that the pseudo bulges are at least close to the correlations, Because if you take any two of these points and merge them once, you'll convert them to a red point, and then they better be on the correlation, because we observed them to be on the correlation unless the merger happened at rates of zero, in which case they wind up here, right? So the story hangs together in a nice way. And that leads us to a list of ways in which we think coevolution might be happening. There are arguments for this list that I haven't had time to give you, so I'm jumping a little bit over a number of arguments, but here's where we find out. This one I showed you, small black holes in pseudobulges and disks don't coevolve with their hosts, we think. There is no sign that the black hole growth has influenced the host, and our galaxy is an example of this mode. And then there are two modes that are really important to know about. One is, I'm going to call, lots of people have called, quasar mode AGN feedback, helps to quench star formation during the starbursts that happen in mergers with cold gas and wet mergers, and those make a particular kind of elliptical that is coreless, disky, and rotating. That is where the magic that we've all been looking for, that it connects energy or momentum from black holes with the host galaxy's evolution. That's the arena in which the answer probably lies. Then there's another arena which is better understood, and which usually goes by the name radio mode AGN feedback. This is feedback into X-ray gas that lives in the galaxy or the environment that the galaxy lives in, and helps to keep the gas hot. And this is sort of less mysterious, because the only job of the feedback is to keep the hot gas hot. And it doesn't have to be AGN feedback as long as the hot gas is kept hot. And although we don't know all the engineering of that, the thing that we do know is that when X-ray telescopes get pointed at these things, they tell us that there's no, or not much, temperature gradient. And so the galaxies know how to stay hot. And it's then our job to fix the engineering. And this might be part of it, but it might not be all of it. Plus, mass averaging and merger may have a significant part of the story. So I'm now at 58 minutes. And the quandary is that the next step is to tell you about the two kinds of ellipticals. And I don't really have time to do that unless you want to let me go over by 10 minutes. So there are two kinds of ellipticals. They're the ones with cores and no cores. They are also the ones that do and do not have X-ray gas. And the critical thing is that there is a mass that divides the galaxies that have X-ray gas and the ones that don't. You have to be more massive than some dark matter mass, which usually is called M-crit, in order to have X-ray gas. And those are precisely the objects that have the properties that we associate with dry mergers. Whereas the objects that are not massive enough to have X-ray gas are the objects in which we then observe properties of the galaxies, which I just glossed over, which are indicative of wet merger starbursts. And of course, this famous picture of the X-ray gas in Perseus A is an example of the process I'm talking about. But I want to emphasize, the important thing is that the X-ray gas tells us by our observations of it that it knows how to stay hot. The question of why is an engineering detail. It's not unimportant, but it's a detail. And any combination of heating mechanisms that keeps the gas hot is okay. And the three candidates are AGN feedback at the middle, cosmological gas infall at the outside, that's what Avishai Dekel would tell us if he were in the room right now, is the main process. And if Jerry Ostreicher were here, he'd say, no, you don't need those two. When stars die, they shed gas, and they shed it at the kinetic temperature of the galaxy, which is exactly the right temperature to keep the hot gas hot. And arguments go on forever in astronomy, usually when all sides are right. And I think this is one of these cases where all sides are right. And the details of which is most important, I want to know, but I'm not going to lose sleep over it. The last thing involves the talking of this story with other stories of quenching. So what I've said so far is that the quenching happens because of X-ray gas in galaxies that are massive enough to have X-ray gas, and I haven't said anything about the low-mass galaxies. And I just want briefly to remind you of the picture of quenching from Simon Lilly's group. This is a plot of the fraction of all galaxies coded in red, which are quenched in various environments as a function of two variables. One is the overdensity of the environment, so fieldish or rich clusterish, and the other is the mass of the object that you're thinking about. And high masses are associated with quenching, and so are rich environments. And the two are separable, he says, and that's what these diagrams say. So here's what he would say are the mechanisms as a function of mass. Mass quenching is quenching by your own X-ray halo, happens at roughly m-crit. Lower mass galaxies that are quenched, he says, are the environmentally quenched galaxies. And we agree completely. And there is one aspect that's new, and that is that we claim that mass quenching, this process, is the same process as environmental quenching. In both cases, X-ray gas does the star formation quenching, and the only difference is that in M-crit mass quenching, the X-ray gas that does the quenching belongs to you, and in environmental quenching, it's still M-crit mass quenching, but the X-ray gas that does the quenching belongs to somebody else, namely your host cluster or bigger galaxy that you live in the vicinity of. So we think that the two processes that I talked about are these. And in both Simon's case and ours, it's not enough to have that those two processes. And here's the bomb-proof reason why it's not enough. There exist S0 galaxies in the field where environmental quenching can't happen, but the S0 galaxy is way too low in mass for mass quenching. So they cannot be quenched by either of these two processes. But those guys all have big bulges. Bulges correlate with their black holes. We think that there's a process of quenching that involves bulge formation. It's wet mergers. And what we would suggest is that the star formation that happens in the starburst in a wet merger starts the process. And that is something that the people who work on ULURGs and things like that would agree with. And maybe AGN feedback finishes the job. That was one of my processes in the list. And Simon calls that merger quenching. So he's coming to the same conclusion. So, second last slide is the summary. These observations that I emphasized resulted in this suggestion of four modes of quenching: no quenching, merger quenching, quenching that's done by X-ray gas, and nothing that's magic, but just averaging. And I'll finish with this slide. Where we have, I hope now, arrived at is a new and richer picture where black holes correlate differently with different kinds of galaxy components, the different formation histories. The refinement of our picture of black hole host coevolution that results in is what I've just now been trying to describe a little bit too quickly, I'm sorry. And the really good news, which I really glossed over, is there are rapidly growing many interconnections between different subjects, like the black hole AGN feedback story and the properties of the two kinds of ellipticals, as an example. And when these kinds of interconnections happen, then your subject becomes mature, and whatever you're interested in is tied with very tough cords to many other things that you know, and that makes the subject much more robust than when this little idea over here is completely unconnected with everything else you know, right? So that idea is also the idea of this famous quote from John Muir: when we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it's hitched to everything else in the universe. And when that's true in a science subject, it means your science subject is getting mature. And I'm happy to say this subject is getting mature, and I thank you very much for your attention.
Questions? Yeah, I have this comment regarding compact elliptical. They indeed evolve along the sequence that you've shown, the Carmody relation, when you strip them. We showed this in numerical simulation in 2009 science paper. And if you start from this dwarf elliptical galaxy and start stripping it, it will also move left to the UCD locus.
Yeah.
On the same plot.
UCDs can be nuclear.
UCDs are really far on the left.
UCDs can be nuclear, right?
Yeah.
I agree with that. But I think that the correlation is what it is, even without stripping. And one of the ways to tell that is that bulges define the correlation over the whole dynamic range of the correlation. And the bulges of disk galaxies have not undergone huge amounts of stripping, because the first thing that would go would be the disk, and it's not gone.
Another question, Charles?
So a little bit of a question about sample.
Yeah.
At the lower end,
M32 always seems to stand out there lonely by itself.
Because it's close. M32.
So you actually have a lot of, you could go a lot deeper and find M32. So must, why are there not more in between
M32? M32s are quite rare. Igor said that. You know, these little dwarf things are a few percent of very tight galaxies.
Half a percent.
So there's nothing anti-Copernican about the fact that M32 looks the way it does. It's a typical example of one of these half percent low luminosity guys. The anti-Copernican thing is that we're lucky enough to live right next to it. And that's luck. The next nearest one has got to be 5 or 10 times. Well, I know some in Virgo. Do you know any in between?
No.
Closer than Virgo. So I know...
5846 and 5848. But it's the same
ballpark distance.
Same distance.
So the next nearest ones I know about are in Virgo, and they're too far away for even HST to find black holes. And in any case, HST hasn't been pointed at them. It's a result that probably won't surprise you if I tell you. I think the general view of HST tax is that this black hole problem is solved enough. And so there is not a tendency these days for either people to write proposals to do more or for this time to be allocated. Now, we're entering a new generation. If you look at what black hole discoveries are being made now, some of them are being made by the Maser folks. They won't find the one in M32. But some of them are being found with AO on big telescopes, and that's where the future is going to be. And sooner or later, people are going to start looking at these guys with AO and big telescopes, and then it's going to be a new ballgame, and I hope there are going to be more points down there. There are also a few bulges that would be down there that have not yet appeared in the diagrams because nobody's looked at them. We could do better. And it's really important to do better because here's the thing that could still surprise us. It's not what I expect, but you don't know until you look. If I'm wrong, and it isn't coevolution magic driven by mergers, but it's just mass averaging, then as you look at classical bulges down at that low end, and don't just lock out on two objects, the dispersion for classical bulges might get big, and if that is big, we're going to revise our conclusions again a bit. So we really do want to know, and they're just hard work. Any other questions, Steve?
Yeah, it's actually a fairly simple question. If true bulges of spiral galaxies are merger remnants,
yes,
why are there still disks?
Oh, the disks are believed to grow afterwards. The stellar populations of classical bulges are generally very old, and the stellar populations of disks range from very old to young. And so some of those disks formed more or less coevally with the classical bulge, we would say immediately afterwards, and others continue to form later as cold gas trickle down into them. There is a puzzle here. There's a puzzle. It's the other main implication of pseudo-bulges that hasn't been absorbed by the formation community. And that is, now that we understand that many of the low luminosity things that we used to think are bulges aren't merger remnants, the number of galaxies that are pure disk galaxies without any merger signs in them has grown enormously. And that means that, as an example, in the 8 megaparsec radius volume surrounding us, 2/3 of all giant galaxies don't have a bulge and don't have a disk and don't have an elliptical. They're pure disks. They're like M101. And when you look at simulations of how halos grow to V-circ 200 kilometers per second, pieces are flying in from all directions. Unless, how can you have a disk which is undamaged when the halo got formed from pieces flying in all from all directions, presumably some of which brought baryons with them? That, I think, is the biggest unsolved puzzle in galaxy formation picture. And when I say this to the formation modeling community, they say feedback, and I say no, it's not about mass, it's about whether mergers happen or not, because the pure disk galaxies are overwhelmingly abundant in the field, and in the Virgo cluster, 2/3 of all stars are in merger remnants. So this puzzle of pure disk is a function of the environment very, very strongly, and a function of mass hardly at all. And until you're using environment and not mass to control your trick, you're barking up the wrong tree. This doesn't mean that I think feedback is unimportant, but it isn't the solution to that problem. And that's a really interesting question. Why are there so many pure disk galaxies? Sorry, I just gave you another talk.
John will be around all day tomorrow if you want to talk with him. He's in room P231 in the ITC area there if you want to contact him or anything. But thank you again, John, for a very fascinating.